So our guest today is Her Excellency Ms. Mmasekgoa Masire-Mwamba, Botswana Ambassador to the Kingdom of Belgium and Mission to the European Union. She brings to us today 30 years of leadership experience in business development and multilateral diplomacy. She is the first CEO of the Botswana Import and Investment Authority. She established Botswana Global Expo, which I believe is happening either soon or just recently happened, and Brand Botswana, right? She created a Commonwealth-wide capacity-building program for youth and women's leadership development, which I hope she'll speak about today. And maybe one of the most important bullet points on my short list, and this is a very short list of her accomplishments, is of course that she's a graduate of Pitt Business and the MBA from the class of 1990. She's here underneath the auspices of our new Africa Business Initiative. The Africa Business Initiative is a way that we at Pitt Business are looking very seriously at opportunities to explore and develop value-added educational opportunities across the Africa continent. So we're looking at partnering as a dominant entry strategy, right? Partnering with established institutions, both educational and also in the public sector. Our initial strategic focus is in the Southern Africa region, and Botswana is highly relevant for us for that reason too. And in partnership with the Center for African Studies, we are doing the Africa Business Initiative, and it's supported by the U.S. Department, partially supported by the U.S. Department of Education. I should say it also has received some funding from a local foundation, the Intercultural Center of Pittsburgh. Some of our early wins, we have partnered already with one of the top business schools in Southern Africa, the Gordon Institute of Business Science. We do, since there are undergraduates here, I will say we do have an upcoming new study abroad for South Africa that's going to focus on our race and business ethics class that we teach here. We're going to do it in Johannesburg in May of 2024. And the most productive thing that we've done thus far, though, is our executive in residence program. And the ambassador is here as an executive in residence for us. And so it's not just her presence, it's not just the knowledge that you'll have today, but it's the way that she's helping us think about our strategy and work tactically to make sure that this partnership works. So, Ambassador, I really thank you, and I hope that you'll join me in welcoming her here. Maybe as a first question, I can ask you as what brought you to Pitt Business, and what has been your professional trajectory since then?
Thank you so much, Paul. First of all, I too would like to welcome the audience that is here in the room and that has joined us online, and say I look forward to a very engaging and engaged in interaction over this. This period that we have. I also thank you for your very kind words, introductory words, and specific to your question, a number of things brought me to Pittsburgh, and I think I would say like three. First of all, it was very unusual at that time to have a focused MBA program that was only 11 months, and I believe it's still going on, but the 11-month program was a big benefit, particularly for us coming from Africa and other parts of the world. It had a very strong international appeal because it meant that you are away for a fixed period and not a period that was not too long, especially if you're already in the workplace. So that was a great appeal. But also at a personal level, my mother had been here and had actually been to the mayor's office in terms of visiting the city. And so when it came for me to choose, she more or less made the selection for me. She said, no, I think I've looked around and Pittsburgh seems to be the answer. So that was the second reason why I'm here. And then I think finally, it's just the quest for higher education that was instilled in me from a young age by both my parents and my father in particular, to say you have to continue to stretch yourself, you have to continue to learn more about the world and to learn more about the areas that you are interested in. So with all those three forces pushing my way, I don't think I had much of a choice.
No, we benefited from that. My colleagues, Jen Petrie Wyman, Caitlin Hudson, as we started thinking about this particular event, and you've had several since you've been in town, we thought it might be good for the audience to hear about how special Botswana is, why it should be on our radar for business reasons, but just in general, what its contributions are globally, because they are substantial.
But why Botswana is also an area that we focus a lot on, because our argument is that Botswana has a lot to offer, has a contribution to make. If I can go back a little bit to how the country came into being, Botswana was a British protectorate. It was not a colony, but it was protected by the British and protected against being taken over by some of the countries that were in the region. And that was important because at that time, Botswana was one of the poorest countries in the world, and therefore it didn't have any way of defending itself or any way of defining itself. And therefore, by asking for protection, it allowed for us to incubate who we are as a people and to incubate our ambition to be recognized as a sovereign entity. So it was not until 1966 when four chiefs left Botswana and a very audacious, you may say, went all the way to England to meet the Queen to say, we think we are ready now, we would like to govern our country. 10 years later, we are able to discover diamonds, which have been the mainstay of Botswana's success and Botswana's positioning. So there are two main stories coming out of the evolution of Botswana, if I can call it that. One was the prudent management of resources. Botswana is not the first country in Africa to discover mineral, but the prudent management of the economy and the mineral wealth allowed it to flourish as an economic hub and as a country that has managed the resources well. The second is that because at the time of Botswana, we were in a very very racially charged environment, with a lot of the regions being ruled under racial prejudice, it was very important when we established ourselves to develop a framework for ourselves. And that framework was built on the tenets of multiracialism. So you look at the flag of Botswana, you see black and white up front and center. This was the ethos that said black people can work side by side with white people, and that was a very important message to send to the region at the time. It is surrounded by blue, which speaks to water. We are a drought-prone country, and it speaks to water as a sign of wealth, as a sign of health, and as something that was going to nurture the development of the country. So I would say both by the way that we embrace a universal value such as a multiracial coexistence, but also through the prudent management of resources, those were two of the primary areas where I think we made a contribution to our region and hopefully at some point to others beyond the region.
And I know, as I've been learning from you over the last couple of days and learning a lot more about Botswana, the focus of our race and business ethics course that we have here, and ultimately the class that we're going to be running again in South Africa, is its focus essentially on interracial relationships and understanding reconciliation, and even the thought of business and commerce as being a mechanism by which that can happen positively. And the diversity that Botswana's story adds, in addition to the stories we've been learning about South Africa, is absolutely fascinating, and it's something I know I'm personally hoping to learn a lot more about. But if we come back to your biography and think about, this is not your first ambassadorship, so that in some ways there's things that you've done that have really set the tone both for import-export, but also as far as diplomacy. Maybe we can you could share a bit about your journey along the way, and after that I'll ask a bit about just maybe leadership lessons or things that it would be good for our audience to think about as far as keys to your success.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Paul. I think in terms of diplomacy, I've had, as you rightly point out, quite a number of opportunities to promote diplomacy as a vehicle for achieving development and democracy principles. I started off in the Commonwealth. The Commonwealth is based in London, and it is made up of 54 countries, quite a significant portion of which were former British colonies, but recently it has also attracted membership from beyond that pool. And so at the moment it sits at about 56 countries. And in that role in the Commonwealth, I was responsible for the rule of law, in other words, for democratic principles, political and human rights as anchors and tenets of a democracy. And part of what we were doing as a multilateral platform was using best practice from different countries to support our membership. The Commonwealth, the unique profile of the Commonwealth is also that 60% of the Commonwealth is made of small states. And small states are countries that had a population of 2 million or less. And therefore, it was very important for small states to be part of a global forum that gave them an equal say and also allowed them to tap into the other opportunities and the other services that were offered by other countries. So that was my first foray into diplomacy. And then further to that, my own country then appointed me as ambassador to Germany, where we were now working at a bilateral level, trying to say how can a small country like Botswana collaborate, work with, and learn from a big economy like Germany. And that's what I was doing for the last 4 years. And it's almost like full circle now, Paul, because in Brussels, I'm having the opportunity to both work at a bilateral level and also a member of the OACPS, the Organization for Africa, Caribbean, and Pacific, yet another strategic multilateral forum that is looking at development issues, in particular trade and other related issues, issues of climate change, issues of scarce resources that are found in a lot of our member states, and how we manage that and how we make sure that the people benefit from the minerals and the resources that they have in their place.
And is it in as a part of your function as an ambassador on these different at these different stages on these different levels that you've also been such a strong voice for women's leadership and the establishment of youth development and youth leadership?
Absolutely, Paul. I strongly believe in the notion of women as agents of change, coming also from a developing country where I saw firsthand the role of women in the development of the country, understanding that the role of women is usually not highlighted when we look at our respective histories. We don't really trace back the role that women in leadership played, but also looking and being, especially in business, where very often I found that there were very few women in the room. My first degree was electronics and physics, and I still recall in a classroom of this size, there were three of us. I was doing physics and electronics. A friend of mine was doing physics and geography, and the third one was doing physics and mathematics or something. So it was just the three of us, and the good news is that the two of us are still very much in touch because we could not be friends given that there was only the two of us. But it is important that we create space for women to contribute. The global challenges that we face now require all of us to apply ourselves, all of us to dig deep and see how we might be able to contribute and to tap into our young people, the youth, for their ideas and their contribution as well.
Mm-hmm. That's great. As we think about this audience, most of them current students, but we also have graduate students and staff and faculty here. maybe, like me, they don't know quite what a day in the life of an ambassador actually looks like. I mean, we get a lot of color on what it means to be an accountant or a business leader, an entrepreneur. Mm-hmm. It might be nice to kind of hear you talk about what a day in the life is like for you now.
A day in the life of an ambassador is really varied and sometimes can be very colorful, but sometimes it can also be very mundane. But there are about four distinct areas that we focus on. The first is representation. First and foremost, you are appointed as an ambassador or as a diplomat to represent the interests of your country. So what that looks like in a typical day could be a presentation of who we are as a country. It could be a presentation of your position on a particular issue. As we now have the global challenges, what is Botswana's position on XYZ? And so that's the sort of activity that you could be engaged in on any day. The second is what I like to call people to people. In any environment, it's one thing for the governments to have already taken the step of saying we want to establish diplomatic relations, but that can only be effective if the people in both the countries can find a way to relate to each other. So the people-to-people diplomacy is looking at the culture, building relationships, understanding what's important to your host country, and what that might look like is, for example, when I was in Germany, looking at and understanding some of the arts and culture that the Germans gravitate around in particular. In Brussels, is issues like cycling and other areas that are important to the ordinary man in the street. And we use that as a way of saying, let's understand what works in this country, both by learning the history, sometimes even attempting the language. I made two faux pas. I started to learn German, and then I moved to Belgium. And first of all, I spent forever getting mixed up between Berlin and Brussels. They both start with a B, but then so does Botswana. And then I also got into trouble with the language because I would start a sentence or French, and it ends up and only because my French teacher understood German, she'd say, I can understand you because I know both the languages, but someone else might have a challenge. So that's a second element, Paul. The third element is that we are really there as part of the advocacy for the global world that we live in. More and more we find in the United Nations, in other areas, there's a common position that needs to be taken. And we try to find, even if we agree or disagree, can we be constructive in a manner that allows us to find solutions that are positive and that contribute meaningfully. So what that might look like is, for example, in Brussels, I'm also accredited to a lot of the institutions based in The Hague. And the institutions based in The Hague include the International Criminal Court, they include the OPCW, which is the chemical weapons, protection against chemical weapons. So these are really grave issues that we need to align our thinking as part of the global community. And so that's another element that we might want to look at. And then finally, I think it's a question of giving back. In societies, we learn from each other. No one is too small or too big to learn from another. And so we learn from each other, we look for commonality, we give expression to common values. And what that might look like is being able to reach out to communities, being able to share some of our understanding, our experiences, and leverage the relationship that we have together to look for new opportunities. And so the final point is, for example, when we talk to businesses and we are promoting trade and investment, that's how we help look for new new opportunities, because we first find out about the environment and we say, oh yes, in our country, this is what we do and this is how we do it. And then business can say, we see a real opportunity there. We would like to come in. We would like to work with you. Mm-hmm. So that's really, I think, four of the key areas where we focus.
Yes, and I should let the audience know, we've had on Wednesday, we actually had a nice meeting with regional leaders to start thinking about different ways that we can create links, cultural links, and obviously commerce and trade between our region, our university, and Botswana and its institutions. So I would ask, given what you just said, are there early thoughts of things that you think that might be good for us, whether it be different industries, maybe industry specific, that where we might be able to mutually start building some bridges?
I think one of the things, if I look back at the history of a business in Pittsburgh as well, is having reorganized and recreated opportunities beyond the steel industry. Pittsburgh had to dig deep, Pittsburgh had to diversify the economy, and Pittsburgh had to attract different types of businesses to come and set up here so that jobs could be created. So that's the kind of relationship that I think we, and positioning that we have. We all know that diamonds are great, they glitter, they bring us good resource. However, they are a finite resource, and therefore diversifying our economy has always been very important and central. How can we diversify? How can we attract manufacturing companies to come to the country to set up, to create jobs? Because I remember even as a student in business school, it was all about how do we create jobs for the workers that and retool and make sure that they have the skill sets that now can contribute to the to the broader economy. So I think there's a lot that we can learn from Pittsburgh. I think the profile of Pittsburgh lends itself readily to say, for a developing country, for a country that wants to diversify its economy, how do we position, present, and attract those companies? And finally, technology and the digital space also provides a great opportunity. How are you in Pittsburgh using the technology? How can we leverage, especially the digital technology and the young people, and create small business opportunities for small business to collaborate and to work together? And that certainly is something that came out very strongly at the meeting that we had in the mayor's office, to say, how can we stimulate the interest and support small business in both directions? Because small business here also might be looking for new markets, they might be looking for collaboration, they might be looking for partnerships. And how can we make sure that they work with our small business to grow their interest in that respect?
And you shared a story with me that I wasn't familiar with, and I would ask you to share with our audience about the impact or the importance of, when we think about life sciences and medical, we hear so much about South Africa and Johannesburg, and I'm as guilty as anybody of consistently focusing in the Southern Africa region only on that city, but there's so many things around that have contributed to some of the successes, particularly on the medical front, that we attribute solely to South Africa. So you shared a story about the most recent discovery, or the discovery about the COVID variant, and how Botswana actually played a key role in that identification.
I think if you recall, sort of like quite early in the COVID era, just as we thought the world was getting over it, suddenly there was a ping that came from far away, and that ping came from Botswana, where we had discovered the Omicron variant, which of course had characteristics of spreading a lot faster and so on and so forth. And so what had happened is that there had been a conference or something that was held in Botswana, and as a routine, our researchers in the medical space were taking samples of COVID and doing an analysis. And they apparently found something in there that they said, this is anomalous. This is not like what we have seen before. And the reason I was sharing it with the professor is that it's important for us to collaborate on research, because it was as a result of a collaboration between a Botswana a research facility and a South African-based research facility that the two professors were able to look at this and say, yes, this is definitely a variant and these are the characteristics. And I had the honor and privilege to host both of them in Germany when they received an award for their work in this respect. But one of the other interesting things that came out of it, Paul, was that we as a country, as a region, we felt penalized for having found something that the world needed to know. And because flights got canceled, and therefore what we are saying is that the support that we give to our scientists and research communities has to allow them to tell us both the good news and the not so good news. And that was one of the messages that they were sending out to say, had we found this and said, if we tell the world we're gonna be in trouble, that would be a different area. So one of the areas that we also talk about is ethics and how we ethical research and how we treat and how we handle our research. So as we are in a research-based entity, it's also helpful to underscore that as leaders, as all you are, both current and future, it is important that the ethical dimension and the collaboration that we reach allows us to be able to say, this is what we found, and to be able to stand behind the science and let the science guide the way. And that was one of their key messages in that respect.
And I really appreciated the research message too, because I think as we get ready to think about Q&A from the audience here, mm-hmm. But what I would say is Pitt Business mm-hmm. has just completed a strategic renewal. And in some ways, what you're saying and your work embodies the core values that we see moving forward, which are built on digital, mm-hmm. healthcare, mm-hmm. and impact, mm-hmm. right? And so in some ways, I think collaboration and being able to elaborate a larger vision mm-hmm. based on our collaboration mm-hmm. feeds right into what our business school is looking mm-hmm. to do much more of in the future. As we prepare for Q&A, was there a topic or any topic that you might want to address that hasn't been addressed in the questions yet?
I don't know, Paul. I think there's a lot to unpack. Maybe we allow the audience to ask us one or two questions, and then we can mop up if there's a particular issue that we want to come back to.
That sounds like a good plan. Mm-hmm. We have a microphone for the people that are watching us on Zoom, so we want to make sure that we get that to the folks who are asking questions here.
Joelle, and I'm at the Center for Sustainable Business. It's a privilege to welcome you here. I'm super excited about the prospect of more of these collaborations between Pittsburgh and Botswana. I know, though, that unfortunately, historically, multinational companies in Africa have been extracted without including the population. So we've entered the regions, but the benefits don't spread to the common citizens. Are there lessons that Botswana, with what you mentioned, that has been really good about managing its resources, can teach other African countries? Or are there warnings or advice that you would give to students that may enter these multinational companies and want to work in Africa, but can make sure that what they do is to the benefit of the people, or as many people as possible in the region? Thank you.
Should I respond? Okay. Thank you so much for that question, and it's a very, very important point that you raise. How do we make sure that as we manage our resources, we are able to the communities around and make sure that they also benefit from those resources? And it has happened in a number of areas in Botswana. First of all, our approach to diamond mining was to form a joint venture with the investment in the diamonds. And so this joint venture was part owned by Botswana, part owned by the country, I mean by the company, and it allowed us to have a stake in the business. Secondly, we have now gone further up the value chain to allow for beneficiation of the diamonds so that some jewelry, the diamond processing, a process that we were told could not be done anywhere else, had to be shipped out, is now being done locally. We were also able to get the central a diamond to relocate from the United Kingdom to Botswana. So a lot has happened from Botswana's point of view in the diamond sector. As a key player, it was important that the country also it's reflected in the stake that the country has in that respect. So I think that's a very key point. How do we as governments make sure that our interests go beyond just what is the amount that we get for our resources? How do we make sure that we have value addition on the ground? The second is actually in the tourism sector. And I know also a lot of African countries have also moved in this direction to say even in the tourism sector, it's important that local communities benefit. We cannot have situations where we just come into a community and say we need this piece of land, we are going to build up the hotel or build up the facility and local community. So there are more and more community-based tourism products that are being developed to make sure that as the tourism industry grows, it also takes and carries along the communities from there as well. I think that leadership is crucial in terms of responding to the global challenges that we face, and one of the roles that we play in multilateral diplomacy is to look for points that are common and points that where we can help each other. I think that communities across the world are able to reach out to solutions and also to reach out by looking at what other communities have done. As you mentioned, I've worked in a lot of different countries. How have the communities that felt marginalized in one setting, how have we come up with inclusion strategies that have brought them to the fore? And so I think that there is a lot that we can learn from each other. And that was also underscored, particularly in the Commonwealth, that it is about we have what are called universal values. Some of these universal values, they don't apply to me because I'm black or because I'm white or for whatever reason. I'm a human being and I deserve to be treated accordingly. And it's a universal need that we all have as human beings. And therefore, human rights become central in our discourse. Human rights and valuing our differences become central in our discourse. And I think those are some of the elements that can create a much more a common understanding and a much stronger bond between the various communities and within the various communities.
Thank you. Questions from the audience? So please state your name and where you're at.
Thank you, Ms. speaking with us. My name is Mike D'Angelo, and I'm a graduate student at the School of International Affairs. I want to ask you about the African Continental Free Trade Area, and just what are some current challenges in the implementation of that?
Thank you so much. The African Free Trade, Continental Free Trade Agreement is one of the newest initiatives that we have on the African continent, and one of the positive outcomes of a political will to do more together. The situation is that at the moment the intra-trade between African countries is extremely low, and this is a way that we want to be able to build that up and also to become a much more dynamic and a global player as the African continent. The challenges that we are facing, I think, are twofold. First of all, as you know, we have 54 countries across Africa, and it is very important that we have common tariffs, we have a common way of approaching and the systems between, the systems that we use in different parts of the continent are aligned. So there's a lot of effort at the moment looking at how do we make sure that there's an alignment in terms of the tariffs and the softer issues that have to do, sometimes referred to as non-tariff barriers. How do we get rid of the non-tariff barriers so that it is easy for a product to weave its way from Nigeria to Botswana, from Kenya to Mozambique, and so on and so forth. So that's one element. But the other element is really access to infrastructure. And that is also a great opportunity for investment and a great opportunity for business development. We need robust infrastructure that enables the transmission and the goods to be able to travel between these places. We have seen both as part of the African Development Cooperation and other initiatives more and more cross-national projects like bridges being built, roads, connecting roads being developed. So there is a lot on the continent that is looking to develop the infrastructure, but I would say those were the two key issues. We always have other unrelated but important issues like skills development, making sure that our skills, making sure that the quality of our products, some of those are also crucial issues that need to be looked at. But top of the range, I would say those were the two key challenges. Yeah.
Other questions?
Well, first of all, I think that this kind of initiative that has been started of the Africa Business Initiative is a very important step in that direction. I think as the business school, it's important for us to learn about the rest of the world, to learn about the issues and challenges that we face so that we prepare leaders that are better equipped to respond and to address some of these challenges that are before us. When I was a student at Pitt, one of the things that I really, really appreciated was where we used to have almost a similar program of having executives who came to speak to us every so often, coming from different parts of the world. But I did note that we did not have any executives coming in from the developing countries. And I think that's one of the key messages to send forth, to say we need to embrace the variety of experiences and the variety of exposure that our students are confront in their day-to-day life. The second is the professor was alluding to earlier, the exchange programs. As students, we benefit a lot by going into different cultures. I was speaking at a different forum and said my studying in Pittsburgh allowed me not just to walk away with what was in the textbooks, but also to walk away with how Pittsburgh, that's why I was able when I got to Botswana to appreciate that this was a country, this was a locality that was looking to diversify the economy, that was looking to, those are things that I didn't necessarily get from the textbook, but I got from being in the environment. And I think that as business schools, we have to find more creative ways. Technology has given us a way out. Technology allows us to reach beyond where we are, and we have to make a much more concerted effort to embrace the global dynamics in our discourse.
Are there remaining questions in the audience? Got one here, two. We've got about 5 minutes. Just doing a time check here. So how long are we going?
My name is Mano, and I wrote a couple of questions down, but I would start. First question I have is has to do with the impact. So how have your experience and identity as a black leader influenced your approach to fostering economic growth both in Africa and in your role as a diplomat in the host country, your lives of blacks in your host country? Are there specific strategies or insights you can share for promoting inclusion, growth, and opportunity for marginalized community? Mm-hmm. So I think after this, maybe I can go back and
Thank you. Thank you very much for the question. One of the things that I did in the Commonwealth, I was based in London for 6 years working for the Commonwealth. But I really made it my own personal mission to reach out to the global community, especially to the black community in the city. And there were a number of initiatives that we followed. One of them was just giving the profile and the support to, say for example, the women in leadership, women in business, and also being able to participate in some of their projects and initiatives. That was one area. But there was a time where I was visiting one country, and they said to me, you know, we have a number of black people who have come here who have naturalized or who have become, but they do not participate in a lot of the projects that we have. And so fortunately, in that particular country, the Speaker of the House allowed us to use his chamber, and we had young and older immigrants who were in that chamber. And my role was to say to them, you know, once you have migrated and you have naturalized, you have as much right to participate as everybody else. So whatever it is that pushed you to be here, you are now here, own it and be part of it. And so I think that's a subtle message that I've really been trying to promote, to say, wherever you make home, you know, your voice matters, your voice is needed, and your voice has to form part of the whole. And don't come in and say, well, since I came in, I don't want to voice my opinion. Because if it's not working for you, then it's not working for you. So it's important to own that. So I think in a nutshell, I would say that beyond the confines of my job, that's the kind of thing that I have been able to do. But it's a really, you know, and for me, it goes down to the second factor that I mentioned when I said, what does a diplomat do? It's the people to people. It's being able to sit down, talk with, relate, share experiences, and leverage the fact that there's a natural connection to allow us to move forward.
And while you're transitioning, I would want to add, it seems to me that some of your presence here is doing a very similar thing.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And that might be, and most of, I would just speak as an African American and as somebody who was there with you last night while we were at Woodland Hills High School, the opportunity for us to interact, to aspire, to dream. In lots of ways, I think that the role that you may play in other parts of the world, you're currently playing here, and it's bringing a lot of visibility to the Africa Business Initiative that wouldn't be here otherwise. And so I think that that's it's very important to say that we're living in a moment where the diplomacy that you do is what brought us here together in this room. Mm-hmm. Next question, please.
Okay, so my second question, let's stay around the international front end, the diplomacy area.
Mm-hmm.
So most often you realize that African leaders, the policies they put in place doesn't favor Africans. And that also does not drive Africans within the diaspora to even come back to Africa and even stay or invest within the African economy. Mostly what they do and then they come back, they realize that some of the promises which were bestowed on them prior to them moving is not the reality of the ground. Now, as your role within the international community, what are some of the initiatives or interventions you did to actually speak to African leaders, especially when they come to the international front, to ask for opportunities, favors, loans, with the aim of coming back with policies that will benefit Africans? But then in reality, you find out that these policies are not benefiting Africans, because the end result is what we are seeing in this recent uprising of coups in Africa. When you also check migration of African labor force into Western countries to find better conditions of services, is also on the rise. So during your time, what are some of the interventions you did? We can use Botswana as a case study to make sure that African leaders, when they come to the international front and they are requesting for opportunities and failures, at least you speak the truth to them.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I think that what we are seeing, and maybe it goes back to the point of your voice matters. I don't think it's for somebody to come from outside and say this is what needs to happen in this country or this is what needs to happen in that forum. I think it's very important that the people are able to articulate and raise the issues and concerns. And one of the areas that we have seen growing in Africa is really the voice of the private sector, the voice of the civil society, and the voice of media. And I think that by coming up with robust institutions, my personal belief is that sustainable solutions come from within. And therefore, if I want to have lasting impact in a particular country or in a particular segment, the best I can do as an outsider is to help strengthen the institutions that can then help the people on the ground to work with them. So particularly that again is one of the key tenets of the Commonwealth, and even in our bilateral arrangements, if I take Botswana as an example, if I find that there are systems and that need support and need to be more robust, that's the level of engagement or interaction that I can request on behalf of my country to say we need help in this particular area.
We have one more question here.
Thank you very much. My name is Meshusha. I'm from the Department of Linguistics. I'm a professor there. So, and also I'm from Center for African Studies. I'm very honored to be here. I just attended this kind of very nice discussion, and I would like to have one question, which is, I think, very important. When you go to the continent of Africa, you see female leaders, they are not coming to the board.
Mm-hmm.
And you have a lot of experience, and you contribute a lot representing your country in Commonwealth as well as ambassador. So can you just share us, based on your experience, how can we bring women leaders, especially for innovation, for industry development, for business? Can you just suggest us kind of maybe strategies to bring women leaders to the board in African continent? Because this is a very important issue, because my friend Adrian presented, if you go to migration, they are really highly affected, truly speaking, more than males, right? Thank you so much.
I think there was a final question here. Maybe I can couple it. I think you had your hand up earlier.
Thanks for remembering.
I think hopefully it's going to touch on everything that was said before me. Sometimes I'm quite skeptical of what business can do in terms of actually serving as a public good. Maybe I'd rather go to the School of Public Health for this kind of conversation, but I'm looking for you to change my mind. Maybe that's something that the Pitt Business School can do as well. So I hope that touches on everything.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. Thank you so much. I think let me start with the women in leadership. I think that's a subject that's very close to my heart, and I agree with you. It is not just on the continent. It is in business. It's everywhere. The voice of women is not fully represented. And in terms of the strategies that we can adopt, I think, first of all, to the women themselves, to us as women, I think we have to show up and also embrace the opportunity to lead. And I think that there are sometimes barriers to us showing up because either when we come from the continent, they may be cultural, they may be familial, they may be within the family context or whatever. And therefore, it is important that we identify what is holding us back as women and how do we respond to that. But it cannot be a situation which we win as women alone. We need our men as our sponsors, as people who also create space for women. I give an example of one woman who I was talking to, who is a member of parliament, and she indicated that when she was trying to get votes for the parliament, she was being castigated by the folk that, you know, as women, you don't come and address us in this arena. And she said, I'm not addressing you as a woman, I'm addressing you as your potential representative. So how do we help our societies also open up for women? And finally, I think the policies that we adopt and the policies and that we promote must be policies that take into account gender. One of the things is when we do our budgets, for example, we have budgets that are gender neutral, that don't say this is what we are doing, and they don't recognize, like the example you gave, we cannot have solutions for migration that are not looking at the peculiarities of the challenges that women face. And if we find a way of addressing the challenges that women face in the migration, in business development, in education, then we are beginning to address that. So it's a big topic, but I'm glad that you asked it, because the more of our men folk who ask that question, what can we do? I think that's when we will start to see the progress. In terms of what business can do, I think that business is an enabler in terms of the social fabric that we have. I think that business can also help in terms of the capacity building, the resources that we need as women in development, the resources that we need for our respective development. So I think that a business is also a microcosm of where we are as a society, and therefore it cannot be that they don't have a role to play in how we progress. Thank you.
Oh, that was an amazing conversation. Excellent questions from the audience too. And thanks so much for stepping up and challenging us to think in different ways and more expansive ways. I would like to end by just saying I do think it's picking up on the points we were making about diplomacy. Mm-hmm. The technology makes it very easy for us to have people online that are in our conversation today, and for us to deliver. But I really appreciate you making the effort to be here in person. And maybe this is against strategic, the strategic thing, but there's nothing like having you here. Mm-hmm. And there's nothing like us being able to dwell together and to have this experience in the same room, and to follow through with relationships in a person-to-person way. So I also really want to appreciate or say how much I appreciate you making the effort to be here. It's very special for us.
I thank you so much, Paul. You started off by asking me a question of what is the role of a diplomat and what do we do in diplomacy. And I think you have teased it out entirely this week. Everything that we have done since we have landed here till today has been about let us promote, let us have outreach, let's understand each other better, let's develop relationships, let's ask the difficult questions, let's make contributions to the global discourse. All of this is what we do in our day-to-day job. And I think that the more of us, I mean, the great thing about diplomacy is that all of us can take on that mantle from where we sit. We all have a stake that we can represent. We all have a stake that we can promote for. And we all have values that we adhere to that we can continue to support and develop as we go forward. So may I thank you very much, congratulate the Africa Business Initiative and the diplomats in the room and those online. Much appreciated. Thank you.
Thank you.